So thanks for tuning in, and I hope that you find this useful. You know, I'm going to talk a little bit about my journey with mushrooms and how I relate to them. And Steve Gabriel is also on this webinar. So we'll be the two instructors going through. And this is a series of three classes. So they're not the same class. They'll be different classes. And this week we're kind of getting the basics of what this grant is that we're doing, kind of talking about the requirements of the grant and why we're doing it, and then kind of begin to go into the mission, goals, and strategy, kind of this what I think is like a fundamental part of mushroom cultivation if you're looking to do it commercially. This is recorded, so you'll be able to listen to it. It'll be posted on both the Cornell Small Farms YouTube page and the Fungi Ally YouTube page, and then wherever the website where you signed up, fungially.com, there'll be a link to it on there as well. Basically, as this project kind of further develops and grows, all the resources will be kept on that that web page. So if you're ever wondering like what's going on, how is it, yeah, what's happening, you can go to that page and it'll be there. Yeah, so that's kind of what we're doing today. And the as I was saying, it's focused towards commercial growers. And next week, I think there will be more information for even just home growers, you know, just anyone wanting to grow mushrooms. We'll kind of be diving more into the methods of cultivation that we're looking at. But yeah, a lot of stuff in here is for commercial cultivation, and I hope you find it useful. All right. So my name's Willie. Happy with some morels, and looking forward to morel season. It's hopefully gonna come up soon. And I've been growing mushrooms for about 8 or 9 years. I started this business, Fungi Ally, back in 2013 or so, 13 or 12. And initially focused on growing mushrooms commercially, and expanded from, you know, 10, 20 pounds a week up to about 200 pounds a week in 2 years. And then in another year or two, I was growing about 500 pounds of mushrooms a week. So that was a pretty big expansion over the course of about 5 years. And it just started out in my basement and using a lab at UMass Amherst, where I had been a student, and just kind of going and after my basement became filled with mycelium, moving to another basement that then became filled with mycelium and fruiting mushrooms. And then we moved to a barn and finally got a warehouse to do it professionally, you know, to really go for it. And as well as growing fresh mushrooms, bring in spawn production. So that was back in 2016 or so, we started spawn production and selling spawn and grow kits online. And that part of the business really took off. So a year ago from now, I stopped growing mushrooms commercially and focused all my time on spawn and grow kits and education. The reason I got into mushrooms was kind of as a strategy to be able to, you know, have my own business in agriculture and buy a farm. So I was vegetable farming for a couple of years. And in my area, I live in the Pioneer Valley in Massachusetts. There's a lot of really good, old, like established vegetable farms. And access to land and a tractor and all the equipment to grow vegetables was difficult for me. But just starting up mushrooms was relatively easy. So the like low initial capital input, and the just, yeah, the how like radical mushrooms are, how cool they are, and like the nutritional, medicinal, mysterious aspect to them is kind of what drew me into mushrooms. So that's a little bit of my story and where I've come from and where I am now. And Steve, you want to talk about you?
Yes. Hi, everybody. Just using my phone here because we've had some issues lately with audio from my home, which is in the Finger Lakes region, New York State, where I was raised for most of my life and left a bit and returned back to in 2005. And I've pretty much been growing mushrooms since then in different ways. My background is really out in the woods, forest ecology, agroforestry, and over the years I've tried many different types of farming and found myself wanting to mostly spend time in the woods or in wood-like environments. And so I'm going to be sharing this webinar series with Willie, and that's through my work with the Cornell Small Farms Program. I'll share some resources later on tonight. Wonderful program. It's a statewide extension program in New York State, though we do end up sharing a lot of resources across the Northeast region and across the country. So I love teaching and educating and learning, being a lifelong learner. And it's nice to see folks continue to just be interested in this topic, something that's captured me and pulled me in along for a long ride in many different ways. So my wife, Elizabeth, and I live and farm on Goyankono, the traditional lands of the Cayuga, part of the Haudenosaunee, and we try to honor the land and steward the land around us that flows into the Finger Lakes of New York State, a beautiful region. And our vision for our farm, our mission really has been to farm in the image or in the reflection of a forest. So we're trying to rehabilitate or support healthy forests wherever they are, and where there's open fields or degraded land, work to heal the water systems and plant trees and reforest it, so that someday we walk off the land one way or the other and there's a forest in our footsteps rather than the pretty beat up farm that we found ourselves on that we got to in 2011. So our farm has a lot of different things going on. Mushrooms fit really nicely in. Connect to our our maple syrup production. We're thinning our woods as we tap our trees. We're thinning our woods for firewood, and this is what led me to first cultivate mushrooms, just to find another use for that material. And since then, as we've built markets and interest in our local region, it's become necessary for us to grow indoors as well, just to extend the season and to grow some different species and have some reliability. And I love that as well. And that really is based in capturing byproducts from our local agricultural systems and forestry systems. So things like sawdust and straw and hay and grain hulls and things like that are all going into the system. And then they're coming out, and we're able to turn those products into mushrooms and into soil. And that's really where I see mushrooms playing this critical role in the way that we can grow them being really important as part of a greater ecosystem. So our farm also works a bit with some animals. We have sheep and do some civil pasturing with them in the trees. And we raise ducks. We sell and produce elderberry. And then we do a fair amount of agritourism as well as education, so bringing people onto the land for lots of different reasons and lots of different ways. So that's a little about me. I'm really honored to be here with all of you and share a bit about mushrooms and dive in. So thanks, Willie.
Yeah, and thanks, Steve. Yeah, it's Nice working with you, and love seeing your model of farming. And I think it's one thing that is really interesting with mushrooms is so frequently they're kind of like a standalone, like it's just the mushroom farm. And yeah, I think there's a lot of potential, and part of this this grant is looking at actually incorporating mushroom cultivation into the whole farm system. And it doesn't have to just be this standalone thing. It can be, you know, one small part of an entire farm system. And we're looking at the natural system, fungi are obviously playing a really important role. So if we're mimicking in any way, then we need to, you know, be cultivating fungi and bringing them into whatever food systems that we're developing. And for this class, my hope is you just get a lot of questions. I hope that, you know, we answer some questions that you have, and you get some more knowledge and understanding of, okay, this is how I could either start a business growing mushrooms, or I could grow them at home. And I also hope that it inspires new questions. It kind of like deepens your relationship with mushrooms and makes you wonder what they are. And I was talking to two people, Hannah and Bobby, who are beginning farmers, and we're interesting the way that farming, when you're outdoors farming, there's this non-human rhythm that you have to pay attention to. You know, the seasonal changes just tell you what you have, what you can't do. And with mushrooms, that's not exactly one of the you can grow year round, and you can grow them indoors, and you can grow them on these different substrates. But that takes out that unhuman room that typically with farms. So kind of curious of where else is that rhythm? Where else does it show up in cultivating mushrooms? And are there other things to kind of tune into and listen to as you're growing beyond just the like grow and bigger and more? Because that's kind of like the cultural mindset is just like more, bigger, faster, huge, take over the world, you know? But that's probably not what anyone here actually wants to do. So yeah, hopefully just putting questions like that into your brain and letting other questions kind of percolate up. And then also, you know, with this grant in general, it's just giving people the basics of like, here you go. If you want to grow mushrooms, here's some options. And now a little introduction for the main event, the mushrooms. I feel like who am I to introduce these beautiful beings? But here we have a nice pink oyster fruiting body, and the fruiting body is just a little snapshot of the full life cycle of fungi. So mushrooms are in the fungal kingdom. And there's three things that make a fungus. They're heterotrophic, meaning they can't make their own food. Their mode of digestion is absorption, so they secrete enzymes outside of their body. And then they secrete enzymes outside of their body, and then digest food and then bring it in back inside, like absorb those nutrients back into their body. And the third thing is their cell walls are made of chitin, right? And chitin is the material that we can't really digest. So 90% of humans can't digest chitin. So the whole idea of like eating raw mushrooms doesn't really work. It's much better to cook your mushrooms or break down that chitin in some way. And it looks like there's a little bit of funny business happening with the photos, and hopefully that doesn't continue to happen. So yeah, hopefully you're all with me on this journey, and now we're looking at some spores. The whole point of the mushroom growing, and that was a pink oyster mushroom. The whole point of mushroom growing is to produce spores. Come out by the thousands, by the hundreds of thousands. And you'll see what we have here on this desk is a spore print. So if you leave a mushroom, just, you know, on a desk, drop all these spores. And the spores are kind of how the mushroom travels. It allows them to move around and get to new substrates. And then from the spores germinate what's called mycelium. And this mycelium is one cell wall thick. So it's really susceptible to environmental changes. So you don't really see mycelium typically just kind of like as you walk around. You really need to kind of dig around for it. So, you know, flipping over a log or digging into leaves or a wood chip pile, or I was hiking today and there's two huge oaks that had fallen over. And in the middle of the oaks, the middle was totally had become soil. So there had been, you know, mycelium breaking that down and probably animals in there. And then what used to be on the inside was just streaks of mycelium. So it was growing on the, when the tree was together, it was growing on the inside, the core of the tree. And now that it had split apart, it was easy to see. But kind of dying, you know, all the mycelium on the outside that was exposed to the environment was going to die back. So the mushroom follows this rotation. You have your fruiting body, and then you're going into the fruiting body producing spores, spores germinating into mycelium, and then back to a fruiting body. In cultivation, we basically skip the spore phase. So we actually don't really want sexual reproduction in mushroom cultivation. So what we do is clone the mushrooms. So you can just take a little piece of tissue. So here's a bunch of different types of mushrooms. And you can just break the tissue and take a little piece of it and put it on a petri plate. And it reverts back to mycelium. So in the cultivation phase, we try and skip that sexual reproduction, the spore producing. But if you're ever out foraging, it's really good to let those spores be spread as you move around. So that's why people use, you know, baskets or mesh bags or something, as long as so that the spores can fall down through those bags and continue to spread. And if I find something like the trees I found today, these big oaks that fell down, say I had found chicken of the woods as well, I would go and just like blow that chicken of the woods, just blow on the bottom of it and try and blow as many spores off of it onto those oak logs. So if you see spots that environmental places that seem like, oh, that's a good spot for this species to grow, you can, you know, just drop spores there and see what happens. And spores are really commonly used in the cultivation of psychedelic mushrooms. So psilocybe, psilocybin is the illegal compound, and there isn't any psilocybin in spores. So you're allowed to buy spores for microscopic, I'm quoting my fingers, microscopic uses. But they're still viable. You know, it's like you could cultivate from them if you wanted to. And the photo here, we've got a lot of different specialty mushrooms. On the far right, this white one is lion's mane, these kind of spine tendrils. In the middle is shiitake. And then this little semicircle is blue oyster, yellow oyster, and pink oyster. So there's a lot of different species of oyster. I was saying earlier, my favorite mushroom right now is the black kings. And that's a kind of like a crossover between blue oysters and king oysters. So the oyster genus is called Pleurotus. And there's hundreds and hundreds of species in that genus. And then on the top left here is chestnut. And chestnut, interestingly enough, in the last 2 years, I just found out can be cultivated on straw, just like oysters are cultivated on straw. I used to teach at UMass Amherst and had a, just a hands-on class, and we ran out of oyster spawn, and I had some chestnut spawn, and one of my students was like, "Hey, can we try it?" And I was like, "Yeah, I don't think it'll work, but you can take a shot." And then 3 weeks later, it was making these big, beautiful fruiting clusters. So chestnut is a mushroom that you can successfully grow on straw, just like the oyster mushrooms. And then down here is piopino, best on supplemented sawdust. And, you know, there's generally like 10, maybe 8 specialty mushrooms that are widely cultivated. And these are, you know, top 6 or so. So that's a little introduction to Steve and me and the mushrooms. Beautiful, beautiful mushrooms. And someone's asking about the bioefficiency of the chestnut on straw. Yes, it was similar to oyster. The one of my spawn customers was getting off of a 10-pound bag of straw, was getting off the first flush 2.5 or 3 pounds of chestnuts. So that's a really good first flush. And this whole grant came out of so I'm gonna like shift gears a little bit and talk about this grant and where we've been and where we're going with it, and how you can be involved. Before that, there's this question about growing chestnut mushrooms outdoors. You can totally, they don't get too infected by bugs. Oysters, blue oysters in particular, I've had issues with growing outdoors because they very, very quickly get larvae in them. But I haven't seen that with shiitakes or yellow oysters or chestnuts. Those would all be good. The chestnuts are a cold loving mushroom. So they wouldn't fruit very well, say midsummer, but you'd get good fruiting, depending on your climate, you get good fruiting, you know, when the outdoor temperatures are going from like 70 to 50-ish, or even down to freezing. I think the chestnuts would love it. And a couple of questions about substrates, which I think we'll wait until the next course or the end of this lecture to kind of get into the substrates. But basically the point of this grant is to kind of twofold. One is create a bunch of resources so that people interested in growing mushrooms aren't starting, where Steve and I started, of like, oh, maybe, just like kind of having to guess and having to experiment and try all these things. And a lot has happened in the last 7 or 8 years of growing mushrooms and in the small scale specialty mushroom industry. So it's really helpful. There's kind of a much higher baseline now. So part of this grant is trying to kind of making that baseline more accessible and available to more people. And making sure people know, what the benefits of growing mushrooms is and the options that are available. And then secondly, we're looking at gathering data on the different methods of cultivation. So we're going to be working with 10 farmers over the course of this year, growing mushrooms and gathering data so that there's clear financial data and startup costs and all these things, so you can look at, okay, if I was going to be growing 50 pounds of oyster mushrooms on straw, what does that look like? You know, how much labor is that? How much is that going to cost at the beginning? How much money is that going to bring in? And same thing if you were going to be buying blocks in. So there's all these different opportunities, and we're trying to get some good numbers on what those different methods can provide. So that you and other farmers can easily say, okay, this will work for us on our farm, or this won't work for us on our farm. You know, this is not a good method and we should try a different one. This is a lot of text. Don't get too overwhelmed. The first three milestones are things that have already happened in this grant. So we just, you know, inform people that the grant was happening, and here you can learn about it. We produced a couple of guidebooks to just kind of, as I was talking about, increase that baseline. And then in November and December, and Steve just did a workshop in January, we ran 9 in-person workshops. So kind of going over, you know, how do you grow mushrooms and what's that whole world like. And now we're in this milestone 4 of going through 3 2-hour or 1.5-hour webinars that people attend and continue to learn about what it is to cultivate mushrooms and how to do that as a commercial option. And after that, where we're going is at the end of these 3 webinars, there's going to be a application that we open up. So during each of the webinars, we'll kind of go through some of the application questions that are going to be asked and guide you through, like, okay, this is how you can fill out this sheet, and here's what we're kind of looking for. And we're hoping for around 30 people, maybe more, to submit a plan and budget to be growing 900 pounds of mushrooms this year. And then from there, we'll select 10 farmers to be part of the process, be part of the project, and we'll grow 9,000 pounds of mushrooms with them. And Steve and I will be consulting with them to make sure that they have any questions that are coming up answered. And we'll also have a group discussion board so that those farmers can be in communication with each other. And the farmers will collect data on expenses, sales, and labor. And then those things will be kind of reviewed by us and then shared with the wider community. So at the end of this, you know, even if you don't, if you're not submitting a grant or part of the farmers or anything, part of the farmers that are selected, at the end, we'll have all this data that you'll be able to see of, like, okay, here's buying mushroom fruiting blocks in. This is what that business looks like. So that's kind of where we're going. And the next step is these 3 webinars and then the application. So just to clarify what you need to, what you need for the qualify to apply and what you're going to be offered is you need to be in the Northeast as defined by SARE. So Northeast SARE is, let's see, Maine, New Hampshire, Vermont, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New York, Pennsylvania, Maryland, Delaware, West Virginia, and Washington, D.C. So though I think that's everybody. You can go on the website of fungiallied.com/growing-mushrooms to see if I missed one, or the SARE website. But you have to be in those states in order to apply for that ongoing consultation. And then this is a typo here. You don't have to be growing 9,000 pounds of mushrooms. You're going for 900 pounds of mushrooms. So what that breaks out to, if you do a 30 week growing cycle, that's 30 pounds per week over 30 weeks. But it could be broken up into anything. You know, you could do 50 pounds for 20 weeks, and that could be your getting to your 900 pounds. But kind of on the setting out, you're aiming to grow that 900 pounds. Grow and sell, right? So selling is as important as growing. You know, and especially when you're buying blocks in, it's like you can start for sales, for growing, if you're buying blocks in, it goes really fast. Like all of a sudden you can be growing 50, 100 pounds. But you need the sales. You need the sales lined up in the market. So that's definitely a really, really important aspect to that. You have to be willing to record sales, labor, and expense data. That might be a little bit daily and some monthly, you know, like recording your sales every day or whenever you go to market, recording your labor every day. And then expenses, whatever you spend on it. And that could be maybe a monthly thing, or just keep track of your expenses as you go. And Steve and I will be kind of checking in with you each month to see how that's going, make sure the sheets that we're supplying to record that data are working. That it's all kind of making sense. And the last thing is you need to be willing to share that data. So we are going to be doing a couple farms will, you know, be highlighted with photos and videos and kind of really get to see what their process is and the data from their farms. Other ones, you know, we won't say a name if you don't want your name shared, but we will use the data, or we might conglomerate it with other, say there's three farmers growing on oysters on straw. We might put those three farmers' data together to get an average. So that's an important aspect to that. So 900 pounds this year. You can go, a little bit into 2021, maybe January, February, but really it's looking at the 2020 growing season. Lots of different opportunities for sales, restaurants, CSAs, farmers markets, distributors, all our farm stands. All are good options. And then what you'll receive for collecting the data and being part of the project is ongoing mentorship. So we'll probably have kind of like a weekly phone calls, or weekly like, hey, if you need something, we're available at this time, or emails, and one or two on-site visits during the growing season. And then $500 in spawn or grow kits, whatever kind of, depending on the method that you pick, you'll get the, you know, in spawn or in grow kits. So that's kind of what we're looking for in the applications. And those will be, the application will be open at the end, like after the third webinar. So we'll do these three webinars. And then if you're still interested and you're like, yeah, this makes sense and I want to be part of this project still, then we'll open the application and you can join or apply. Okay, whew, yeah, That's good. I feel like I'm like, I got to shake that off. That's a lot of like deep nitty gritty details and grant world. But important. It's important to know this stuff. And let's see. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. Steve, can you think of anything else that we need to like share around that realm, or that seemed good? And the spawn grow kits will be, it'll be like a credit to buy those from whatever spawn or farm, like whatever block production farm you want to use. And you know, we'll just figure out how to do that. So it's during the growing season, you know, whether, you know, if you're starting in April, anytime from April all the way through December. And the application will likely be a Google questionnaire, Google questions. And then it'll have a couple of templates for budgets and mission goal strategies and that sort of stuff. And then 900 pounds can be inside or outside. So you can, you can do either. Okay. And here's the three methods of cultivation that we're looking at. So there's, if you want to be part of this project, this is basically what we're doing. The first one is growing oyster or chestnuts on straw. And next week we'll go more in depth in what these processes are and how to do them and stuff. But the first one is oyster, chestnuts on straw. The second one is buying in supplemented sawdust blocks. So there's companies like Mycoterra in Massachusetts or Cap and Stem in Maine or K&S Sales in Pennsylvania that just sell ready-to fruit blocks. So the second way is buying in ready-to-fruit blocks and fruiting them. The third way is making your own supplemented sawdust blocks. So that would include having a lab and making your own blocks and doing that whole process. Yeah, those two and three are the same right there, but the difference is one, you're buying the blocks in, and the other, you're making the blocks yourself. So those are the three methods that we're looking at, and it could be a mixture. And you know, you could also be growing mushrooms another way, but we wouldn't really be looking at data for that. What we're wanting is to gather data for these three methods. And there's a question of, is one method the most economical? And that's such a highly variable question. And part of what we'll do next week is look at the pros and cons each. Like oysters on straw is probably the lowest cash flow, right? So if you're going for like very lowest investment, have some space, then probably that's going to be your best bet. The second one, buying supplemented sawdust blocks in, is probably your next highest. It requires a little bit more cash flow. And the last one, the making your own supplemented sawdust blocks, requires knowledge of a lab and building a lab and definitely a lot more infrastructure than the first two. But yeah, next week we'll also give you some tours of farms to be like, hey, this is what this could look like if you're doing one of these methods. Okay, so if you want to apply, you gotta wait. just wait 3 weeks, keep coming, come next week and come the following week, or check out these videos on YouTube. We will open up the application, the day after the end of the third one or something. And we'll be introducing resources as we go of like, hey, here's a part of the application. Make sure to, you know what's going on with this. Okay, so we're going to just take a little like 4-5 minute break. And if you have any questions or anything, just put them into the chat box. And yeah, we'll get going again in, I don't know, yeah, 4 minutes, 5 minutes. Okay, lots of great questions. Thanks for asking them. One question that I do want to hit on is, can you elaborate on the 10 farmers growing 9,000 pounds of mushrooms? And that is, yeah, basically we're expecting the folks that apply for the ongoing consultation to aim to grow 900 pounds of mushrooms this year. So between all 10 farmers, they'll grow 9,000 pounds of mushrooms. So that's kind of what that's all about. Yeah, and the whole building a lab and that part is really essential for the supplemented sawdust because it's a high nutrient material, but not really as important for straw. So building a lab is beyond this conversation. In getting access, sometimes if you have connections to a university, that can really help. Yeah, and you don't need a lab to grow mushrooms. That's a really, really big thing. Okay, so some current resources, if you haven't seen them already, on that page that you likely signed up for this webinar, are these two books, Commercial Mushroom Cultivation and Specialty Mushrooms Cultivation, which are like a book one and book two, for, you know, getting kind of an introduction into what commercial mushroom production is. So I highly recommend checking these out, and a lot of the information that we talk about over the next 3 weeks will be in there. And just kind of like, if you kind of follow that, you can definitely start growing mushrooms commercially. Pretty straightforward. There's also on my website, there's other cultivation guides, shiitake, oyster, cordyceps, our little booklets like this, which are just free to download. So feel free to check out any of those resources. And there's lots of blog posts and YouTube channels, YouTube videos and stuff like that. Eric Myers is a really good, Myers Mushrooms is a really good YouTube channel to look at. And if you want kind of a bigger scale commercial cultivation, Earth Angel is a good one as well. So those are good resources and lots of information that you can get from those online resources. And then the Cornell mushrooms, Steve, you want to talk some about what's going on there?
Sure thing, Willie. So cornellmushrooms.org is our extension homepage that has a whole nother set of resources that are great companions to the ones that Fungi Alley and others offer. If you go to the homepage, which you can just simply get to by Googling or going to cornellmushrooms.org, you'll find these five different sections. And it'll just kind of walk you through the process. You can look at different options for indoor versus outdoor production and what we have available in terms of videos or printed guides or articles. We are working on a number of resources, as Willie mentioned, sort of in the indoor realm, so there's less published there at this moment, but it's going to continue to grow. We're going to release some new videos soon and provide updates on our research and things like that. And then we're going to also be breaking out these booklets that we worked on together that Willie just shared about and posting those as individual articles as well in that section. So our project is, and a lot of extension work, is research and extension based. You can go on to the next slide, Willie, if you want. And what that means to us is we work to couple data collection and understanding of what research has been out there and pull that together and share that through educational efforts. So right now we are starting a trial at Cornell campus. You can see there the steamer that we're using to treat some straw. I was just in there today doing some inoculation, looking at straw production in terms of the time, labor, materials, comparing that to ready to fruit blocks. So looking at the two methods of cultivation that are most applicable for small diversified farms or to kind of get started without a lot of infrastructure. And we'll dive again, as Willie said, into those a bit more next week and kind of compare the pros and cons, because they all have their place in different contexts. And that's your job, is to kind of figure out which one fits best with your goals and with your situation. And then just to mention, too, in addition to what's on the website, we do have a series of webinars. We do monthly webinars. We'll be picking those up again in March. And there's a tiny URL there that you can go to, a whole playlist, including a nice webinar that Willie did about his whole journey starting Fungi Alley, but you can learn a lot from that and the others who've been on our program. So you can keep rolling there. And I just want to mention, too, another SARE project if you're in this region, and we are certainly not trying to exclude folks that are outside of the SARE region. Actually, I think on here the states are all listed. Yeah. This is SARE is a national organization. They split it up into different regions, and then folks can apply from those regions to do these projects. And if you're in a region that isn't covered here, again, you can still have access to a lot of the resources we're creating. It just might be there's a point when you can't participate because of that. But maybe if these are projects that you like, you can think about trying to apply for funding in your region. And we're happy to share our process and help as much as we can. But I just wanted to mention another opportunity, which is focused on increasing This grant's really focused on increasing the growers who are growing mushrooms. We also want to increase the educators educating other people about mushrooms, because there's just so much interest and not enough folks teaching it. And so if you go to our website here, the short link, we call this the CME, or the Community Mushroom Educator Training. We're offering an opportunity for folks to apply to be a part of a cohort that'll learn about how to put on a mushroom inoculation class, a basic introductory class. And we're looking for a wide range of folks to do that in a wide range of places around the region with lots of different types of communities. So I'll leave it there. If you're interested in learning more, you can go to the website and see a video, check out a webinar on that, and consider applying for that.
Sweet. Thanks, Steve. I definitely missed some states when I listed those off. So that's, thanks for that.
I had to remember them all.
Yeah. Thanks for that complete list. Okay. Very good. All right, so we're gonna go into some jumping around here. Okay. Hopefully you're with me on this mission, goal, strategy slide. And this is where I think all commercial farms should start, is clarifying kind of this top-down approach to guiding the farm. So we're gonna walk through some examples of mission, goals, strategy, and talk a little bit about how to make those for yourself. Mission for me, the mission that my business has is to create a world of balance and connection while revealing the power of mushrooms. So whenever there's kind of a decision to make, I refer back to this mission. And it's interesting because the first 5 years of growing mushrooms, I didn't really have this. I didn't have like a guiding star. You know, I didn't have a like, okay, this is the direction that I go and this is how I make decisions. Like, this is really what I value and want to hold center. And so really what kind of took over was just like growth and expansion and more. And I think that can very easily be the default, is just like keep growing and produce more. So it's really important, if you don't want to just go to that default, to take some time to really illustrate a mission. One of my friends, Pete, he has a facilitation business, and this is his mission: creating brave spaces for transformation, healing, and movement. So you can see they're pretty succinct statements. They're not too specific, right? There's a lot of things that can fall underneath them. And they act as this kind of guiding post. So the two pieces that I see in a mission is your core values and how you're bringing those core values into the world. So it could be, backing up here, create a world of balance and connection, or just create balance and connection, or create a community of balance and connection. You know, it doesn't have to be a global mission. You can have it be as small as you want, or just kind of leave that framing out. What I've found to be super helpful, if you don't know core values, just type this into Google, core values worksheet, and you can find something like this. Let me see. Let me switch my share here. Okay. So I think you should be with me on this list of 230 personal core values. And what I would do is just go through here, this exercise that I did to kind of find the core values that I held, is basically go through this whole thing and circle 10 core values. And after circling 10, reading through it once, go through and cross out 5, right? So you're left with 5 core values. And then with five, go through and cross out two more. So you're left with three core values, and then cross one more out. So you're left with two core values. This, you can just find this really easily. Google search personal core values sheet or just core values sheet. And that's, there you go. That's kind of like the beginning of your mission. Create a world, say happiness and hard work is what you ended up with. Create a world of happiness and hard work by growing mushrooms or by, I would recommend doing something more broad than growing mushrooms. It could just be by having a relationship with mushrooms, or, you know, whatever it is. Or it might not even, it might be more food oriented or, you know, whatever. Yeah, lots of opportunities there. So that's a good beginning exercise to start to clarify what your mission is. Okay. And then, yeah, just that, like, how are you doing it? What's the, process to create, to fulfill, for like bringing those values into the world? And then once you have your mission, you go down to goals. Goals, these are the two goals that I have, you know, generate $40,000 in profit and teach 1,000 people about mushrooms. So again, the goals are very succinct, straightforward, and there's not a lot of room for interpretation. You know, it's clear, like, yes, I made this goal, or no, I didn't make this goal. And this isn't like a shaming thing. This isn't like, you didn't make your goals, I'm like, I didn't make my goals, I'm bad, I'm not enough, what am I doing? It's just a benchmark thing. It's a way to say, okay, great, this is my goal. Well, now I know I need to make, you know, $800 a week of profit. Okay, great. How am I going to do that? Yeah, I don't want to, my relationship with the goals, I don't want to be this like negative, like, oh my gosh, I have to do this. I actually want it to be this like, oh my gosh, the opportunities. I want to generate $40,000 of profit. How can I do that? Let me explore all the different ways that I can do that. And what way would feel really good, you know? And so this is a time when clarifying those goals, clarifying exactly what it is you want, and then you can explore the strategies to make those goals happen. And you can, you know, test stuff. Be like, okay, I'm going to try this strategy. It's not working after 3 months. Okay, I'll switch. And I'll switch focus. The acronym for making good goals is SMART. You want to make SMART goals. That is, they're specific, they're measurable, attainable, so it's not like a crazy way out of your spectrum, relevant, and timely. Okay, so you want them to be in a time frame, say it's an annual thing or 6 month thing. When we look at this, it's right, generate $40,000 of profit. Profit's important here for it to be specific, it's measurable, $40,000. This is an annual goal, timely, relevant to what I'm doing, it's a business, and attainable, right? I've been doing it enough so that I've been doing it for 8 years. So, okay, I think that can happen. And then you go down to strategies. So the strategies for this is, okay, I want to generate $20,000 in profit through three different grants. And the second strategy is $20,000 through online spawn sales. Okay, now I have these metrics of, okay, this is how I'm going to do it. And these can be further kind of drilled down of like, what exactly do I need to do to make this happen? And I'll show you about that with Wandering Farm. So this is a farm that I consulted with, and we kind of went through their mission and goals. And this is what we started with, kind of shifted it some, like really made it more succinct. So the beginning mission was considerably longer, but you have here healthy and sustainable, right? So that's kind of their two core values in the community. So instead of world, they're using community, and just through mushrooms, it's like through mushrooms, just whatever is happening with mushrooms. And they added while generating a steady income. So that's an important aspect. And so that's a clear mission. Good. That's kind of their guiding star. If they have decisions to make or trying to figure out what exactly they want to do, they can come back to that statement. And then these goals were kind of transformed into, particularly this first one is a SMART goal. Second one is a little bit harder to be like, yeah, this happened or didn't happen. But we'll kind of drill down further into this first goal of generating $26,000 in profit. So looking at that, okay, they were saying they want $13,000 from mushroom cultivation and sales and $13,000 from educational tours and walks. So, not imagining that all that would come from mushroom cultivation and just looking at, say, $13,000. So if we look at this strategy and say that mushrooms are sold at $12 per pound and the cost of production is $7, then the profit per pound is $5, right? And those numbers can all be kind of changed to fit your scenario. You know, maybe you're selling at $16 a pound, or maybe you're selling at $10 a pound, and maybe the cost of production is $4, and maybe it's $10. So those can all be changed to figure out what your profit per pound is. But now there's that number, $5, and we know, okay, we need to sell 2,600 pounds of mushrooms. Add that into a year, and you know, if you're doing 52 weeks, you need to sell 50 pounds per week. And if I want to sell 50 pounds per week, then I'm going to grow 60 pounds per week. So now we've gone from this kind of abstract mission of, you know, who knows what that means? Like, how do I make that happen? To, okay, I'm going to grow 60 pounds of mushrooms per week in order to fulfill that mission. So this is a really good way to kind of drill down into exactly what it is you want to be doing on the farm and why you're doing it. And then if growing 60 pounds per week isn't generating this profit, you can say, okay, what's going wrong? You know, is my average price lower? Is my cost of production higher? Am I not able to grow that much? And what's a different strategy that I want to try in order to meet this goal? So it just allows more flexibility and, wiggle room in exactly how you create things that how you fulfill the goals and the things that you're trying to do. Okay, so there's a sheet. Let's see. There's a sheet that you'll be able to download on the Fungi Ally website, the Fungi Ally Growing Mushrooms website, that will have kind of the places to fill out the mission and the goals and the strategies. So you'll be able to just download that and fill that in. And I recommend taking some time, as you make the mission statement. So it can start out really long. You know, don't feel like you have to have it perfect right at the very beginning. Just kind of get some stuff on the paper, start the process, and then from there, you can kind of start making it a little bit smaller and getting a little more details. And from there, you'll be able to figure it out. This is the worksheet, really basic. You have your mission right here, goal one here, strategy one here, and then kind of drilling down in the same way of like, okay, this is, say your strategy is to, generate, like we said, generate $13,000 of profit growing mushrooms. Then do those assumptions of it's going to cost this much, I'm going to sell for this much, so I need to grow, 2,600 pounds a year. So I'm growing 60 pounds per week. And that's what you're aiming to get here is I want to grow, you know, X amount of pounds per week. And if there's another goal, you can add that in. And or if there's another strategy in under this goal, you can just add that in. And this will just be available, like I said, in the fungially.com/growing mushrooms. Okay, so we can look at, let me look at the questions that people have been having. And if folks have questions about any of that, then just let me know. So here's a question. On average, the cost per block is $7 for production. Is that the average? And usually if you're buying supplemented sawdust blocks in, they'll cost somewhere around $6, including shipping, maybe $6.50. And then add in, you know, utilities, harvesting, packaging material or something. And you'll get a total, you know, $7, $8, $9, whatever it may be. I would recommend saying $7 or $8 if you're buying blocks in. Maybe go conservative and say $8 if you're going to purchase blocks in, and have them shipped to you for the cost of production. And the blocks tend to fruit, you know, about a pound and a quarter. So I would aim for one block per pound. So just if you want to grow 30 pounds of mushrooms, aim to, you know, buy 30 blocks per week. The question here, does each state have the average cost of a pound of mushrooms? There are terminal prices, but those are, you know, people selling thousands of pounds of mushrooms. What I've seen is typically retail sales of mushrooms is somewhere between 10 at the very lowest up to $16 dollars per pound. And that varies per species and what they're grown on and the quality and all that sort of stuff. The mushrooms pictured here are shiitakes. So these are shiitakes grown on logs out on the Cape. Nice. Are there any colossal fails that anyone is willing to share so the rest of us can be aware of the pitfalls? Oh, that's good. Yeah, I think having some of those stories is super helpful, and I'll see if I can think of one for me. I don't know if anything pops up for you, Steve, of like, oh, that was bad. but definitely, you know, every grower struggles with contamination and just kind of trying to figure out where contamination came from and why it's there and how to get rid of it and all that sort of stuff. So that's something that, yeah, everybody works with and deals with that sometime or another. I had a colossal fail of, like, I got in a shipment of blocks. I got, you know, maybe 200 shiitake blocks shipped in, and it was July, and I didn't put them in the walk-in cooler for about a day or 2 days, and they all just cooked. They totally just kind of, because the blocks, they generate heat, you know, so they'll just sitting next to each other, they'll kind of cook each other. So I just left it out, and most of the blocks died off. So that was like a $2,000, just kind of like ate, you know, just because I didn't move the blocks into refrigeration. And if you are kind of having blocks shipped to you, having a walk-in cooler or some sort of larger refrigeration is really helpful and pretty much necessary. And the blocks that I'm talking about are 5-pound blocks. There are companies that do 10-pound instead. So you can And usually those are 750 each, and they produce 2 pounds of mushrooms instead of 1 pound of mushroom. If you're pretty strong and don't mind moving large weights, then those are great to go for. You know, there's a little bit less labor with the 10 pound blocks just because of, you know, economy of scale. And yeah, I think for, in terms of like who you buy your blocks from, it's really helpful to find someone local. So I have a list of block providers around the US, and a lot of it's kind of word of mouth and just figuring out who is near you. I can share maybe next week or something, I'll share that list, and just find someone close to you. And that's the biggest thing, because shipping becomes a really big issue. And the third book, so we're going to be doing the third booklet, which is going to be more like case studies and data that gathered from this year. And that will be published June of 2021, somewhere around then, June 2021. This is good. Kitty has a question. If you were to start a farm from the ground up, how much square footage would you recommend for a commercial operation? If I was starting right now, if I was starting a mushroom farm, or if I was starting to grow mushrooms, I would do it outside. And I would do ready-to-fruit blocks outdoors in low tunnels. And I would just have like a walk-in cooler and a little packing area, maybe in a barn or something. So that would be, you know, maybe 300 square feet or something like that. And then just do all the fruiting outside and do it seasonally. That is a lot more appealing to me right now than year-round cultivation. If you're looking at, say, a 200 pounds per week indoor cultivation, you're probably going to want, and you're buying blocks in, you're probably going to want, you know, something like 1,500, 2,000 square feet. Yeah, and we'll talk next week. We'll talk some about growing oysters on straw, which can be done in buckets for less plastic waste. So if that's something that's hanging you up, then definitely an option. And the Unicorn, who's one of the really big bag producers, actually produces a biodegradable bag now. They're not biodegradable just on, they're not biodegradable like at a home compost, but if you send it into a, you know, larger, composting facility, they can break down. So that's a positive. And I think definitely growers that I talk to, the big thing that, they struggle with is just the amount of plastic waste and having to throw out plastic bags over and over. So, hopefully that can get addressed. And, you know, the ideal is if could successfully grow and, what was that? There was a, microspora. There's a species of mushrooms that can break down plastic. And so if you could get that growing, then it's like, wow, here we go. We just are breaking down the plastic with the mushrooms. But it's a hard culture to get. And I think that research is still very much at the beginning. Okay, question about packaging. What do you recommend for display packaging? Yeah, sending back, always store mushrooms in paper bags. And I just use the berry containers, you know, what you see strawberries or blueberries in for display. And you can also do bulk, just, you know, if you don't want to pre-make pints for people, you can just put them in bulk and then put it straight, like in a basket or something, and then put that into the paper bag. What I found when I was growing it, selling at farmers markets, is when I started to sell by the pound, so selling at $12 a pound or $15 a pound instead of by volume, is my my average sale went from $5 up to like $6.50 or $7. So there's a lot more making change and stuff, but the average sale actually increased because people were just like, oh, I'll have half a pound, you know, or oh, a little more. Okay, that's good. So that's something to explore at the farmer's market. What are some grow space options if you don't have a basement? Let's see. Well, yeah, and we'll get into this more next week, but barns, low tunnels in a shady area, build a greenhouse just in the shade, warehouses, tractor trailers or shipping containers, all those are all those are good options. Let's see. Okay, yeah. So seeing if a second or third flush come out of the block, and this really depends on species. With shiitake, typically I just do one and done. I try to put them in a place outside where I can still harvest from them because they will continue to fruit outdoors. Oysters, I will just leave in the free room and let them fruit two or three times. And then, you know, hopefully they stay good. And same with lion's mane. Lion's mane will just keep producing. So as long as those ones kind of stay clean, I'll just leave them in the grow room. But shiitakes generally require a soak to fruit for a second time. So it just becomes a lot of handling. So I just put them outside and then try and see them when they're popping. Instead of a cooler, would a root cellar be okay to put blocks in? Ideally, you want to have them down at like 38 degrees. So I try and keep them at somewhere around there, 38 degrees. And this is cool. North Carolina, if you're looking for blocks, moonlightfarmsnc@gmail.com. So Anna is making blocks and can hook you up if you're in the North Carolina area. In the third class, we'll be talking more about like legal issues and insurance needs and all that sort of stuff. Spent mycelium and spawn, that all just goes into compost. So what's amazing is, other than the plastic, the mushrooms make incredible soil. So, you know, that's really what they do, is they convert dead organic matter into basic building blocks for plants to use. So just making a huge pile of spent blocks, just all these worms come and break it down and make amazing soil. So just pile it up and let it decompose, let it rot. And these logs right here, these are sealed with cheese wax, the ones that were are on this photo here. And we won't be talking about shiitakes on logs during this webinar. There's a lot of really good YouTube videos, and on Cornell there's awesome on the resources that Steve shared. They did a similar project as this one with log cultivation, so on that website there's a lot of good info for log cultivation. So a question about how do you deal with bugs growing outside? And this is definitely an issue, particularly with oysters. What I've found is best is just to grow species that don't get bugs on them. So shiitakes are one of those where there just isn't that much bug damage. There can be some slug damage, but bugs kind of tend to leave them alone. Sometimes there's thrips in there. When they get really old, they get brown spots. But if you pick them young, like at this stage right here, they're beautiful. So that's the biggest thing with outdoors is just, I just don't grow blue oysters outdoors. And otherwise, you're pretty good. You could try Rime, but it's kind of a pain in the butt. Yep, we'll talk about lime pasteurization next week. Wow, this is great. I'm like answering questions and there's way more than I can keep up with. How long is the growing season for low tunnel cultivation in New England? It's basically from April through October for shiitakes. And I was working with a farm when I first started selling blocks back in 2016. I was working with a farm, Fat Moon, and she was growing about 150 pounds of shiitakes a week and just had a walk-in cooler on a trailer and then three low tunnels under a bunch of oaks. That was really basic infrastructure. She probably put, you know, maybe $2,000, $3,000 into it, and was able to be growing a lot of mushrooms per week. I haven't heard of any farmers buying spent blocks for as compost, but they might, or maybe you can find someone that will let you make a big pile and still have access to it. Yes. Yeah, the slug. What do you do about slugs? Steve's like, we've got ducks. Ducks eat slugs. And for shiitake logs, what I've done, and I've done this for blocks too, is actually just put down four bricks and then put a pallet or 2x4s on the bricks so it's off the ground, and then put the logs or the blocks on top of that. And the slugs don't like going up the bricks. So that's what I've done. Necessary to have drains in a commercial fruiting room? Nope, you don't have to have drains. It's super helpful, but definitely don't have to. Let's see. Question here about how big is a low tunnel? Can kind of be as big as you want, but the ones we've used are like 5 feet across and then just kind of went as far as we want. I think they were like 5x30 or so. Okay. Great. That's awesome. I think that's all the questions that we've got there. And it's 8:00. Cool. Well, thanks everyone for coming. If there's any other questions, let's see. Yeah, if there's any other questions, bring them next week. And Steve will be leading us next week, and we'll be diving more into the three processes and kind of less like, hey, this is what our grant is, and more focus on the mushrooms. And this part's really important. So I hope as homework for next week, look at the mission goals statement sheet and give it a shot, you know, just fill it out, see how it goes, and we can talk about it next time, or just I'd love to hear about how it went for you. So you can use the same link as you used tonight for next week, and it'll be the same time, And yay, good job. That was really fun. Thanks for coming and thanks for asking questions and being excited about mushrooms, and look forward to seeing you next week.